Welcome to everybody on my YouTube channel again. You guys didn't see me in the last couple of weeks because I'm so busy on my other projects and on my daily works. So now I want to show you guys what I scored on eBay again, because I'm always buying something on eBay which is dead or halfway dead or something like this, and then I try to repair and use in my daily life. And this is actually how I decrease the cost of my hobbies. So now I scored on eBay. Sorry guys, I just want to show only the box because the device is already on my table, and I forgot to start to record when I start to do the repair, but of course I will show almost everything what I did. So this is actually a Lilliput monitor. It is the 665GL, and I think this is the SP version, which is meaning it has HD SDI input. So the guy who is listed on eBay, he wrote it like just simply not switched on. So almost all the time when I'm looking for something which has an issue or it's not working, the best way or the best articles, if it's simply not switching on, because if it has some kind of weird display issue or lines on a display, or it's not showing to you all the colors or something else, its meaning will be really hard to repair. It's true also on audio gear. So if you are looking on eBay for secondhand not working units, always try to find the units which is not switched on at all, because most of the time all those problems it came from the power supply unit, which is really easy to repair. The Lilliput company did a very nice job on the power supply unit, because it's so open, so it can run on 7 volt, on 12 volt, on 24 volt, on a battery, on a AC adapter. But unfortunately, as always, Murphy doesn't sleep. So they installed this common choke filter into the power supply unit, which is a nice part because it's made by the TDK, and the name of it, it's ZGY2P01. And I did a research on the internet. This part can hold up until 30 volt and 2 amp of current. So how it can die? I think the owner, when he plugged in some kind of really heavy, big capacity battery, because this display it has this battery holder, I think when he switched on the first capacitor in this power supply unit, it's drived this on a very high but very short time current, like I don't know, maybe 10 amp or 15 amp, who knows. So unfortunately this part is dead inside. So on the end I scored this display for 62 euro including shipping, and I did the repairment. But let's now talk about the stupidity of the factories. They think the three main thing it's very important for you as a buyer to force you to buy a product. One is the looking. The second one is all the other physical impressions like touch, smell, whatever. And the third one, just the third one, is the technical descriptions and what the device can do for you and what kind of possibilities you will get. So Lilliput and a lot of others, Logitech, Microsoft, Sony, even Panasonic, LG, Samsung, everybody, they use this stupid rubberized soft touch coating on all cheapy plastic product. So what does it mean? They produce the product from cheapo plastic, like polyethylene, polyurethane, poly whatever poly, and of course all of this plastic, it has this cheap touch feeling, the human sensing. It's very interesting because we can touch and feel what kind of material used on a product. So this is why all the professional products, real professional ones, they are using some kind of aluminum alloy or magnesium alloy or even steel or ceramic, and all the rest, they are using cheap plastics. So because they are using these cheapy plastics, this lightweight, and the smell is like a plastic, and the touch like a plastic, you know what I mean. Because of that, the make of a spraying and coating with this rubber soft touch material. And the problem with that, I think everybody know it. The problem with that, even in 1 year or half year of normal using, I'm not talking about daily using or heavy using, just time to time you pick up the product, doesn't matter if it's a camera or a camcorder or a monitor or remote controller or phone or whatever, even if you're just using time to time, in 1 year I can guarantee you this soft touch feeling, it's start to be sticky and loosey and looks ugly and smell like ugly and bleh, you know, it's like a fiak. So Lilliput, I don't know why you did that, because you targeted, let's say, a semi-professional or even a professional market. So please don't use this rubber touch shit, because this is actually a shit, a fiak, ugly. So when I get this monitor, of course it has the same problem. The old owner, I think he used for one and a half year, and I'm telling you guys, when I take out from the box, I almost drop immediately into the garbage, because I don't know this monitor has this soft touch. So please, companies, find some kind of other material and paint with that, or just simply use higher quality of plastic. It's so simple, so easy, and nobody will think on your product after half year, what is this shit, I want to drop to the garbage. Because a lot of people, they don't care about how to clean and how to modify and how to make shiny or remove these things. No, they just simply drop into the garbage, and this is also not good for the planet. I'm telling you, guys, stop this bullshit. We don't need at all this soft touch rubberized feeling, because after couple of months of using, it became rubberized shit touch. So what I did, I did a search on Google how people are try to remove this rubberized coating from their products, and everybody is saying different. And of course, because the base material, this plastic, It's also different. It can be urethane, ethylene, I don't know what kind of plastics we have now, or HDPE or whatever. Of course, if you read something on the internet and you try to apply on your device, on your product, yeah, it can defect your plastic. Or opposite, like it will not doing nothing with the rubberized coating, because of course from this rubberized coating paint material, it also exists a lot of different kind. Two component, water-based, polyethylene-based, I don't know. So I'm not lucky with that. And I'm telling you guys, nothing, nothing wants to be worked on this Lilliput 665SP monitor. So, and then, in the past, like 3 months ago or 4 months ago, we did a demolishing of a movie theater, which is based and operate on the normal IMAX movie, so nothing digital, it's fully analog. And in their maintenance room, we find a lot of different chemicals, which is so specialized on these film projectors. And I find this material. And sorry guys, I even couldn't recognize what is this, but it smells like a bit of ammonia and kind of this weird chemical smell it has in. And I'm telling you guys, this, I just touched softly with the cloth and I put on the rubber, and after 20 seconds the rubber is almost jumped from this monitor. So I'm really lucky with that. I cannot show you nothing about name or brand, because this is actually how it's kept. So maybe if you are interested on that, start to look on Google what kind of chemicals it's used by maintenance of this film projectors. I think it's for remove the residue from the film tape when the film tape is burned into the projector. So it's really, it can dissolve this rubberized sheet from the monitors. So I did the cleaning with that, and of course after I neutralized with hot water, with cold water and whatever, and then I did I adjusted my tap to really cold water, like 10 degrees or something, and then I applied this normal sanding paper, which is 400, 600 and 800. I jumped up from 200 to 800, and I did a smoothing of the surface, because this chemical a bit, not too much, but a bit is eaten also the plastic. I simply just painted the back to the black. And I used for that a normal black paint, which is designed for metal. And I applied, I don't know, 2-3 layers or something like this. And then I get the surface without this, sorry Lilliput, without this rubberized sheet touch of feeling, I get this very nice black metal looking surface, which is also really hard and really high quality of touch. And I also did on the back, sorry guys, I want to show you. And so I also did on the back, say this is just my touch from my fingers, but you can see it's really high quality of the surface, what I get from this after this rubberized removing. And this is actually how it looks like now. So again, dear companies, don't apply this rubberized gummy bear soft touch coating. It will not help you to make people happy from your product. It's simply not. So please stop it. And on the other side, I also don't know the whole chemical process, what you guys in these companies invented to make sure this rubber sheet, it can stick on the plastic. So I'm 100% sure it's a really worse for the planet. So please, again, stop. We don't need this sticky touch on our mouse. We don't need this sticky touch on our tablets and cameras. No, we simply don't need. Please find a better, a normal colors and paints and apply this or just simply left the plastic as is. Okay, so I don't want to talk about more about this, so let's now show you guys how I repaired this power supply issue in this monitor. So originally in this monitor, the Lilliput designed to use this common choke filter from the TDK, and by a definition on the white paper, it's showing to you one coil is running from this pin to this pin and the other coil is running from here to here, and basically this small common choke filter, it's exactly the same like this, what you can find in almost any power supply unit. And basically it's very simple how it works, because if you just do one coil and you apply the current which is running from this direction or to this direction, it will create a magnetic field like this. So this is the situation when you have one coil. If you have two coils, so let's say this is the negative and this is the positive, the current is running into this direction, and then the magnetic field will run in this direction. If you have two coils, which is coiled on the same direction, then you will get a magnetic field which is, let's say here is your unit what you want to power, and if the current is running from this direction, let's say this is the positive, to this direction, then the magnetic field one will look like this, but the other it will look like this. And of course, because of this configuration, if you have on the power line a kind of high frequency content, of course this will be the same on the other side, and this filter in this combination will never filter out, because the two magnetic field is running opposite, so the two magnetic field will not kill itself. But in the common choke filter, you have one coil which is coiled in this direction, and the other it's turned into the other direction. So what is mean? Here is your product what you want to power, and when you apply the positive here and the negative here, this magnetic field will run in this direction, and the other magnetic field, because it's opposite like the other, it will also run on the same direction. So because of that, if the high frequency noise it exists on the power line, because it's very simple to understand. Here is your power supply unit, let's say this is the PS, and this is your device, and all the magnetic and electric field radiation is infecting all the capacitors and transformers and transistors and everything. So it's basically its effect same waves on the positive line and also on a negative line. And because of that, the high frequency content, it exists on the positive and also on a negative, but on the same polarity. So, and then the common choke filter is just eliminate this, because the really high frequencies, they cannot go through the coils, because the coil has the impedance which is related to the frequency. Let's say this is the impedance and this is the frequency. It has this logarithmic shape. And let's say it is some 1 megahertz or something like this, and this is 20 megahertz and something like this, and because of that the coil itself, it's already do a filtering because of the impedance is always changing by the frequency. But if you apply a common choke, which is normally they connected together with some kind of ferrite inside, so all the magnetic field is running inside, and it's kill itself. So because of that, this shape, it looks much more higher. So you can imagine around, for example, in this case, in this part, around 100 megahertz, this impedance is so high, but because of this structure, the DC easily can pass through, because it's nothing more for the DC, just a piece of wire. And so that's it. And this is the difference between the new technology and the old technology. But unfortunately, this puppy is die on a one side. Let me show you. So it is my old trusty 87, not a V. And here you will see, this is one coil, it's working, but the other is not. So that's life. So I can imagine when the owner, the old owner, he attached some kind of battery and he switched on, it can kill this small common choke filter, and maybe on the bottom or on the side you can see this brown burning footprints or whatever. So it's definitely dead. And but then after I try to find some kind of common choke filter in other PCBs, because it's mainly it's also used in communication for block the high frequency content which is collected by the phone lines. So in the past I see that on many modems, but unfortunately nowadays in these PCI modems there is no common choke filtering at all. This is for example a DSL modem, and also on that I couldn't find this common choke filter. But it has own power supply, but they are not applied. So let's go to the next one. And you know, again, I couldn't find it. It is the power supply unit, and they just have one not common choke filtering. Let's jump to the other one. Here I also couldn't find anything which is something like this, and then in this router, which is made by a Vodafone, it's a very high quality Wi-Fi and USB sharing and firewall and whatever, and this is a very high quality board itself, and on that I find not one but a lot. So here you can, maybe if I'm zooming in, okay, so here you can see this is one, this is the second one, and there is more, but unfortunately this part in this Wi-Fi modem, or what is this, a router, the current is not designed to up to 2 amp like on the Lilliput monitor. So then I start to think, maybe if I take out two pieces and I install to my monitor, it will be happy, but not, because it's rated only 0.4 amps until 20 watts, if I remember good. So yeah, I have, but unfortunately is not good for the Lilliput monitor. So then I looked, of course, in other salvaged PCBs, but I couldn't find nothing, and this is what I did by hand, because the original, because this original, it's designed to stop the high frequency content around 100 megahertz, so they just throw about the 2.4 gigahertz and the 900 megahertz from the normal cell phones and the Wi-Fi's and from the cameras or whatever. So this is actually why they applied this common choke filter, to eliminate all the very high frequencies from the gigahertz ranges. Here you can see, this is the two coil what I made by hand, and I also replaced this capacitor to a bit higher value, because originally here it's installed 1 pico or 2.2 pico, something like this, and now I changed this to 1 nano, which will block much more lower frequencies from the power supply, and that's it actually what I did, and this is how I repaired my 60 euro Lilliput 665 monitor. Of course, I did a lot of measurement in other places, make sure everything is okay. I checked all the capacitors, all the coils, and this thermal fuse. So this is why I said to you guys on the beginning, the Lilliput, even the Chinese company, here they did a really nice job, even if they not use the most highest quality parts, but I'm telling you guys, all this design, when I draw it down by hand, I mentioned, yeah, this is a really nice job. So this is why I don't understand the Lilliput, because if they have very good engineers to design PCBs and design electronics, why they listen to the marketing department, okay, ooh, now the product is done, so, oh, and I touch it and it feel like cheap, so let's apply some kind of rubberized soft touch on it. No, please, no. If you, Lilliput, if you have a proper designer and the proper engineer group to design your product, please don't fuck up with this rubberized soft touch feeling, okay? So yeah, let's finish it and put it together, and you guys will be really happy how the monitor will look after this, let's say, pro-looking finish. So this is the back. So let's put together. Good. Let's have a look last time. And now just I will not screw it together because can be some problem with it. Okay, if I switch on, yeah, you can see here some kind of green LED is light up on the bottom. So now we're running from my Sony battery. And look, ta-da! It's working really fine from even battery. So let's add the HDMI signal in it. And operate. Ta-da! Oh. Voila! Voila! It's working perfectly. And I'm telling you guys, this monitor has a very nice picture from look from atop. So let's now put everything together. And of course, when I did the paint before, I just covered some things on it. So let's now open these coverings. But before I take off this masking tape, I cut a bit on the side because who knows, it can pull up the color also. It's maybe not the best looking, but hey, for $60 DSLR monitor, it will be nice. No. So here it is. Now guys, tell me, is that not looking professional without soft touch feeling? Without gummy, I like it. And okay, now I want to show you guys something else. I don't know how I can show you, but yeah, I think I can show, because if I'm going into the settings and I do back as original, let's say, okay, let's say manufacturer default, and I mentioned this LCD and this firmware, it's by a default, it's driven to the crazy amount of sharpness, so this is also, I don't understand this menu. Why just default? Now I have to jump from the cancel to the OK and press with the other button. It's unbelievable. So now, if you can see, maybe you can see. Yeah, I don't know how, but we'll try. No. Okay, maybe. Yeah, now you can see. This sharpness, look around my finger. Yeah, this is the best. Look around my finger. This outside is my real finger, and this inside is my picture finger, and you can see these edges here, it's a so too sharpened. But if I'm just switch on the histogram, this sharpness will go. Now you can see on top of my finger, you see this black line, and after there is this white ghosting. And if I switch on just the histogram, this will disappear. You see that? Now the picture is much more natural. And you see, this is the original color, and this is what. So let's now just switch off the histogram, and everything is come back to this ugly. To here you can see how the process is going. Original, not fully black, like 90% black. Here outside. Here it's already 100. Here it's more in the no. You see, but if I just switch on the histogram, somehow the processing of the picture, it will gone and disappeared, and all the CPU all the CPU power is just concentrate on the histogram. Look, so because of that, all the settings from the picture, it will gone. Look, pack. You see that? Much more closer. Don't see this third one. Here, sorry, don't see this third one because it's already looped back, but see this and see the real one. It's so close together. So what you can do with that? Of course, if you switch on other things, it's also we get much more better picture. It's meaning for me, they default, they applied some kind of crazy settings on the color or on the saturation or something, and let's everything applied to the middle one, 100, 100, half is 50, tint be 50, and saturation be 50. Now the color, it looks almost okay. If you see my skin tone and you see the skin tone here, it's almost close together, but this phenomenon with the sharpness is still there. So if I switch on the histogram, everything is came much more natural. So why? And of course here in the menu, you cannot find where is the sharpness because they want to hide from you the sharpness because they are overdriving the sharpness to get better, let's say better looking. But this is the point when I don't understand them. If they are the targeted market is the pro consumer or semi-pro, why they not give you a possibility to adjust the sharpness and these weird things? No, you cannot find here. There is temperature, pixel, blah, blah, blah. And center maker and language input, blah, blah, blah. And there is no possibility to no possibility to change the sharpness. And what you can do here on the rotation button, one of these, because this the tint I really don't care because I always do some kind of white balancing on my cover. Sorry, my fingers is get this dirty looking because of this black color. So let's go to the menu and replace the tint to something else. Let's see if we can find it. And this I also don't understand. Now I'm staying on a menu and then I, until now I have to press and but now I have to turn the other one. It's like, I don't know who designed this, but he must has to be fired. So now, instead of pressing, turn, and then you have to turn other. And then when you find it, you have to press, or not press, turn again. Annoying. So now the third one, it came to be the sharpness. So let's switch off this menu and let's go back to this view. You see, this is normal, no sharpness at all, and this is over sharpened. So let's now turn, because they, by a factory, where they put it? On 50. Thank you, but what are the 50 is meaning? What the 50 is meaning? So all the way down, now it's zero. And if you see the picture, it's much more nicer, much more better, and it's not have this over sharpened shitty. Maybe if I just add couple. Beautiful. So now the picture of this monitor is just beautiful and the whole monitor became like a professional looking, and I'm really happy with that. for 60 bucks. By the way, this screen also I think a bit hopeless, you can see. In this direction it's good, so it's representing good the color. From the side it also looks good, and from this side it also looks good, but look what's happened when you... it's going almost negative. And this is really bad, because on the camera you never want to change the, your head, you cannot change the head position and you cannot grow up higher. But what you can do, and you always do that if you sit down or something, so your head is only changing from up to down. And actually this display is designed opposite. So if I'm... now you can imagine, here is the camera and I want to go down, look, it's almost gone. It's total black, useless, and the colors get weird. But on the other direction it looks okay, and to the side it looks okay. So why then not apply some kind of other acid which is produced from this direction? So okay, let's know this is the end. And unfortunately the top surface is didn't dry it well, so yeah, I did here some kind of fingerprint. And but otherwise I'm really happy now with this display, because it's not have this rubberized sheet and it's working, and it just cost me 60 euro including transport, and that's it. I'm happy. Catch you next time.